Hold it down. Hold it down. And you better not let nobody crash you out. And you better not let nobody bow you out. Welcome back to another live recording of the Hold It Down podcast show. This topic is about if the black community was to be rebuilt, it should be here. Let me change that. They are corrected. It should be in Africa. There's no way we can rebuild Black Wall Street or the community in America. Let's get into this shit. And why the black community 2.0 and where it should be rebuilt at.
So I'm about to explain the history of ancient Nubia and their beef with Egypt nearly in totality. So ancient Nubia is probably the most confusing history in all of African history, hands down, because it's largely understood through a lens of an ancient people who had absolutely no idea what they were talking about. We can thank the Greeks and the Romans for that. What up, African world? It's your boy Home Team here. I'm back at it with another video of African history, culture, and worldview. And today we're going to talk about ancient Nubia, one of the most classic African civilizations ever. So like I said, the Greeks and the Romans pretty much confused the issue when it came to Egypt's southern neighbors. Which, to be honest, is not really a fault of their own, because they tried their best to really understand the people they had little interaction with. So the ancient Greeks romanticized and mystified the ancient Nubians by largely calling them Ethiopians, and the Romans usually called them Nubians. According to the ancient Egyptians, you had different types of southerners. Some of their southerners were a huge threat to Egypt, some not so much, and some probably didn't care either way. Also, the Egyptians never called their southern neighbors Nubians, nor did they call them Ethiopians, for that matter. Lumping all these groups of people together would have been absolutely detrimental to Egyptian society. In fact, the ancient Egyptians made several distinctions between numerous ethnic groups of the south. Some of them they liked, and some of them they feared, and for good reason. But for the purposes of this video, I'm periodically going to call these people Nubians, and then make distinctions between numerous Nubian ethnic groups. Now, before we talk about Nubian history, we must first understand the demographics of the region. Now, there were pretty much three dominant Nubian groups. You had northern Nubians like Wawat Nubians, you had eastern Nubians like the Meja, and you had southern Nubians like the Kushites. Now, there were definitely more Nubian groups, but most of the others were either directly or indirectly related to the most dominant Nubian groups. So for this video, we're just going to focus on these three, mainly because we don't really understand the other Nubian principalities. So of course, when the average person thinks of Africa, they're immediately drawn to the wonders of Egypt. Egypt is touted as the most ancient civilization in Africa, if not the world. Here's the thing though, Egypt is not the most ancient African civilization, nor is it the first significant state that arose in Africa. The oldest civilization in Africa and the first significant state to arise on the continent was called Tassili. And as you all might have guessed, Tassili was an ancient Nubian civilization. Tassili means land of Set or land of the bow, because apparently these Nubians were excellent archers. Tassili was around in about 3500 BC, which makes it one of the oldest, if not the oldest, civilization on planet Earth. Now the question is, what kind of Nubians were they? Well, some scholars suggest that these Tassili Nubians spoke a Nilo-Saharan language, and extended their rule all the way up into southern Egypt. So this would mean that Nilo-Saharan Nubians created the first civilized state in Africa and even ruled parts of what was later to be called Egypt.
But then out of nowhere, this Egyptian man named Narmer unified the entire region and all the chiefdoms, creating the first Egyptian state, which led to the end of Ta Seti. The work of King Narmer led to the rise of all the pharaohs and the end of the first Nubian state, Ta Seti. So of course, yeah, the Ta Seti Nubians weren't too happy about this, and our beliefs have sort of reinvented themselves.
We need to learn that language of the Ta Seti. We really need to learn that language. See, it's already, everything is already waiting for us. All we got to do is put some money over there. From Egypt, all the way down, all the way over to Somalian and Ethiopian, all the way to Nigerian. Kush gonna unite all of Africa. It's the only kingdom that haven't been talked about yet like that. And we gonna see why.
I was at multiple locations, but the main locations and regions seem to have been Wawat and Kerma. So let's talk about our first Nubian group, the Wawatians, if you will.
Now, when it comes to Wawat, here's where it can get extraordinarily confusing. Let's keep in mind that Wawat is just a regional name, not necessarily an ethnic classification. Wawat was located in northern Nubia. Now, because Egypt conquered their old homeland of Ta Seti, these Wawatians were somewhat Egyptianized in culture. And at times, the Egyptians enlisted the services of Wawatians, and other times, Wawatians advanced their own needs and concerns. Some scholars suggest that Wawat was pretty much the front line for Egyptian resistance, as they were the immediate descendants of Ta Seti. Wawat even expanded itself, conquering other Nubian chiefdoms in the south called Erjet and Satju. So Wawat, from an Egyptian perspective, was a pretty inconsistent region concerning their loyalties toward Egypt. Amenemhat I said, "I seized the people of Wawat and captured the people of Meje." One of the clear-cut depictions we have of Wawatians is from a tomb which depicts the princes of Wawat, one prince being named himself Hakenefer, the prince of Wawat. Here, Hakenefer is being depicted as a vassal prince paying tribute to Egypt. Now, the confusion may come in because these people with the iconic feather on their head.
Hakenefer. That's a crazy name. King of the Hubak. Also take notes. I'm gonna go into deep to how a black man helped Israel in ancient times.
Heads will later be known or associated with a distinct group of people. You'll understand a little later. Now let's talk about the Meja. The Meja Nubians are well documented and are considered a completely different ethnic group. We can refer to them as the Eastern Nubians because they mostly
in Mejas. This shit crazy. This got all our renaming. Said This shit crazy. It's right there, written for us, ready to be resurrected. Because in America, it ain't going to get rebuilt. The black community ain't going to get rebuilt. You can wish and hope all you want to. But in America, the black community and Wall Street will never be rebuilt. But in Africa, there's a 50-50 chance. In the Sudan Desert, north and south, for starters.
Reside in the Nubian Desert. In fact, the Mejia are so well documented that we know their direct descendants today, the Bija people. The Mejia were hands down the most friendly Nubians toward the Egyptians. The Mejia and the Egyptians literally worked hand in hand and frequently intermarried. Very rarely did the Mejia have beef with the Egyptians, and in general, they were reliable. The Mejia were very highly valued as soldiers in the Egyptian army. Around the Middle Kingdom, the Mejia were reported to have lived east of Yam and south of Wawat. The Mejia worked in all parts of Egyptian society as palace attendants.
Even though they had different names, they all still had the same bloodline.
Attendants, temple employees, merchants, and more. The Mejia worked in Egyptian fortifications in Nubia and patrolled the deserts alongside Egyptian soldiers. The ancient references to the Mejia is typically synonymous with police or judicial administrators. They protected pharaonic interests. When they served as mercenary troops, they were noted especially for their fast infantry or later cavalry attacks. It seems very clear that the Egyptian
mercenary troops. So you might as well say we the world's first mercenary. That's why they don't want us to know about Kush. That's why they want to keep saying and have us keep thinking we descendants of slaves. So they could keep looking at us weak and we could keep thinking like we weak and play the victims. Like we strong, but we know we ain't strong enough than y'all. I call it all bullshit. We gotta go back to the ancient times.
Egyptians viewed the Mejia as related or similar to themselves. Now, before we talk about the Kushites, we need to talk about karma. Bear with me, because it's hard to explain who the Kushites were without mentioning Ta Seti, Wawat, and Kerma specifically. Now, like Ta Seti, Kerma developed into a powerful state and advanced their own culture and architecture independently from Egypt. Kerma seems...
They don't never talk about Kerma. You just hear what he said? Let me slow it back a little bit.
Kerma developed into a powerful state and advanced their own culture and architecture independently from Egypt. Now, like Ta Seti, Kerma developed into a powerful state and advanced their own culture and architecture independently from Egypt. Now, like Ta Seti, Kerma developed into a powerful state and advanced their own culture and architecture independently from Egypt. Now, like Ta Seti, Kerma developed into a powerful state and advanced their own culture and architecture independently from Egypt. Kerma seems to have been sort of the second breakaway homeland of Ta Seti people and culture. The state formation of Kerma is dated at about 2300 BC. Egypt, of course, had major beef with karma. The significance of karma.
Look, that's a 3D model of what it would have looked like back then. Now, just imagine today's technology, and we changing the look of it.
Karma rests on it being the oldest major kingdom in Africa south of Egypt and having a character and culture that is clearly not Egyptian but uniquely its own, all the way down to the architecture itself. Karma was very successful and had major resources, but Egypt sought to control it. Karma quickly becomes a very powerful state, just as Ta Seti was. Karma goes on to conquer other Nubian states in the region, such as the Sai Kingdom, and becomes the dominant force in the south. By this time, Karma is a huge threat to Egypt. This is where Egyptian propaganda began, as they needed to insult and belittle the Karma Nubians in order to justify domination. Then, seemingly out of the blue, Middle Kingdom Egyptians began to use the term Kush to refer to the Karma. Region. This is the first time we specifically hear this word Kush being used. Essentially, Egypt started hating on Kush because not only did much of their precious resources come from that region.
Was that the first black on black crime? Egypt started hating Kush? Huh? So it don't go back to slavery. It goes all the way back to ancient times where we was all free, where all our real history at. The black on black hate. Sound like a foundation, black Americans versus Africans.
But they knew they had a genuine rival in which they had to compete with. So who were the Kushites? You see, the Kushites seem to have been a sort of hybrid ethnic group. After Wawat and Karma began to conquer.
So they was a hybrid and ethnic group, whatever how you say that. So they was what, black mixed with black? Because where else the fuck they going to be mixed with? That word right there got me curious, like a hybrid. But they all black, though. What was they mixed with?
Conquer other Nubian regions and tribes like Erjet and Setju and Sai, they began incorporating them into their society. Seemingly, these groups of Nubians intermingled with each other and created a new ethnic group. Apparently, the Egyptians saw all of this and noticed that these people were essentially a combination of all their fears. Thus, a new name for them had to be created, Kush. In a sense, the Kushites always existed amongst the Ta Seti, Wawat, and Karma Nubians, The Kushites sort of inherited a new name for them. Had to be. These groups of Nubians intermingled with each other. And Sai, you see, the Kushites seem to have been a sort of hybrid ethnic group. After Wawat and so who were the Kushites? You see, the Kushites seem to have been a sort of hybrid ethnic group. The Kushites. You see, the Kushites seem to have been a sort of hybrid ethnic group. The Kushites. You see, the Kushites seem to have been a sort of hybrid ethnic group. After Wawat and Kerma began to conquer other Nubian regions and tribes like Urjet and Setju and Sai, they began incorporating them into their society. Seemingly, these groups of Nubians intermingled with each other and created a new ethnic group. Apparently, the Egyptians saw all of this and noticed that these people were essentially a combination of all their fears. Thus,
damn. They seen a threat. The Egyptians did. They saying, damn, we gotta still fuck with these motherfuckers anyway. Cause they basically are the people who we gotta do business with.
A new name for and created a new ethnic group. Apparently, the Egyptians saw all of this and noticed that these people were essentially a combination of all their fears. Group. Apparently, the Egyptians saw all of this and noticed that these people were essentially a combination of all their fears. Group. Apparently, the Egyptians saw all of this and noticed that these people were essentially a combination of all their fears. Thus, a new name for them had to be created. Kush. And created a new ethnic group. Apparently, the Egyptians saw all of this and noticed that these people were essentially a combination of all their fears. Thus, a new name for them had to be created. Kush.
So, since they ain't know what to call them, they call them Kush. Let's find out what Kush mean.
In a sense, the Kushites always existed amongst the Taseti, Wawat, and Kerma Nubians. The Kushites sort of inherited their ancient memory from Taseti, their rebellious spirit from Wawat, and their uniqueness from Kerma.
We gonna rewind that again. So these people were strong and smart.
Their rebellious spirit from Wawat created Kush. In a sense, the Kushites always existed amongst the Taseti, Wawat, and Kerma Nubians. The Kushites sort of inherited their ancient memory from Taseti, their rebellious spirit from Wawat, and their uniqueness from Kerma. Sort of inherited their ancient memory from Taseti, their rebellious spirit from Wawat, and their uniqueness from Kerma. Inherited their ancient memory from Taseti, their rebellious spirit from Wawat, and their uniqueness from Kerma. The Kushites were a powerful group of Nilo-Saharan Africans. In fact, the Kushites nearly destroyed Egypt. Many people aren't aware. In fact, the Kushites nearly destroyed Egypt. Powerful group of Nilo-Saharan Africans. And their uniqueness from Kerma. The Kushites were a powerful group of Nilo-Saharan Africans. In fact, the Kushites nearly destroyed
Nilo-Saharan Africans. That's who the fuck we are.
Nilo-Saharan Africans. In fact, from Kerma. The Kushites were a powerful group of Nilo-Saharan Africans. In fact, the Kushites nearly destroyed Egypt. Many people aren't aware, but sometime during the Middle Kingdom, the Kushites invaded Egypt and nearly destroyed it. Had the Kushites stayed in Egypt, that pretty much would have been it for the Egyptians. Luckily for the Egyptians, the Kushites didn't seem very
Did y'all hear that on the back play? If Kush would have stayed in there, it wouldn't have been no such thing of Egypt. They would have been wiped. It would have been wiped off history if they chose to stay there. I kind of wish, because God had different plans. Like if it was, Moses probably wouldn't have been born. Well, it came down the Nile River, so.
Very interested in occupation. They went raiding for precious objects, merely a symbol of domination. It seems they simply wanted to send a message. Kushite kings possessed substantial wealth and power. After the high soul.
You heard what the fuck he just said? They just wanted to send a message. Like, look, if we wanted to wipe y'all ass out, we could. This mixed breed of black people that had three different traits of other different people, other different groups of black people could have wiped their ass out. The black community 2.0 is them. Egypt wasn't shit to compare to them. What it seems like. But we're going to get into Egypt too. Because Kush and Egypt needs to fuse. Because you see that this type of black people, they was mixed. So they was fused. Three different types of black people. Pure black people. And that came and almost wiped out Egypt. Now, just imagine Ethiopian, Kush, and Egypt fusing together.
Soaks conquered northern or lower Egypt. A High Soaks king wrote to the ruler of Kush to propose a joint alliance against the Egyptian pharaoh, Khamos. Why have you risen as a ruler without letting me know? Have you seen what Egypt has done against me? The ruler who is in it, Khamos, is attacking me on my soil, but I am not attacking him in the way he had done against you. He chose the two lands to persecute them, my land and yours, and he has ravaged them. Come, navigate downstream. Do not be afraid. Behold, he is here with me. There is no one who will be waiting for you in this Egypt. For I will not let him go until you have arrived. Then we shall divide the towns of this Egypt. So it seems as though the Kushites were supportive of the High Soaks, but not in totality. If Khamos didn't intercept this message to the Kushite king, that probably would have been it for Egypt for good.
Y'all hear that shit? It was only interrupted. If it wasn't interrupted, Egypt would have been through. Egypt would have been through.
The Egyptians right now were literally in the belly of the beast. They had the High Soaks who conquered the north, and they had the Kushites in the south who clearly had the capacity to finish them off. The Egyptians were pretty paranoid and upset at their southern neighbors after they successfully expelled the High Soaks for good. This is why we consistently hear the Egyptians in the New Kingdom refer to their southern neighbors as vile Kush. For obvious reasons. Thus, Due to Egyptian paranoia and propaganda, they attack Kush and conquer it so that they don't have to compete with them any longer in the future. But who are these Kushites, and what are some of their cultural characteristics, and how were they
Yeah, they was conquering each other back and forth. They didn't go too deep in Kush, though, because they know that's you know, we got power. But it was going back and forth between Thebes, the city of Thebes.
Depicted. In order to get a fair picture of who these Kushites were, we have to see how they were depicted by themselves and other cultures. We have a plethora of depictions of Kushite captives and even Kushite royalty. Our first image is of a Kushite captive depicted by the Assyrians. Our second image is of a Kushite royalty depicted by themselves. Our third image seems to be a relative culturally or linguistically to the Kushites, perhaps from a sister tribe. We know this because this ethnic group is often portrayed by the Egyptians as allies to Kush, or even being identical to the Kushites themselves. Kind of like how the Egyptians intermarried with the Meja. There is diversity amongst the Kushite identity, so it's important to note that. Not all Kushites throughout Kushite history are the same. So during this time of Egyptian occupation, unique Egyptian elements begin to seep into Kushite culture. Even Kushite art begins to change into a more Egyptian style. This is what confuses many people, because the Kushites began to use Egyptian-styled sculpture, but they began to use their own style once they moved to their capital, and it began to differ and become more realistic. Anyway, sometime in the 11th century BC, the new kingdom of Egypt weakens and Kush becomes independent. Interestingly enough, there seems to be a sort of Kushite ideological revolution that begins to take form. Kushite elites and kings begin to spew this narrative that, wait a minute, we are the originators of Nile Valley culture, and we are the rightful heirs. Thus, we should control and dominate the region. This Kushite Renaissance obviously spelled disaster for not only Egypt, but other non-Kushite Nubians. Thus, King Pi sailed up and conquered all of Egypt. Then he spoke these words, "Lo, who has led thee? Who has led thee? Did heaven rain with arrows? I am content when the southerners do obeisance, and the northerners say, put us in thy shadow. Thy gnomes are full of youths." So basically, the Kushites were feeling themselves. They conquered all of Egypt and ultimately believe that they were the originators of Nile Valley civilization. And to be honest, they probably had some fair points, because in reality, the Kushites were either directly or indirectly descended from Taseti, the original Nile Valley civilization.
They knew their history, and they kept it. Even though they was different breeds, but they had all the knowledge of all three different type of groups. And they just didn't go just for one. They went for all three, because they all three, they are hybrids of the first civilization. Basically, the next generation, which I call the Black Community 2.0. If we was going to rebuild in America, it's over. We might as well not even try over there, because it ain't gonna work.
The iconic cultural features for Kushites seem to have been the ostrich feather on the head and the plaited hairstyle, a style that became very popular in Egypt, the same ostrich feather seen on the Wawat Nubians. King Pi conquers all of Egypt and begins the Kushite Empire, leading to one of the most prosperous eras in Kushite and Egyptian history, and a renewal of Nile Valley culture. His purpose was clear because after conquering Egypt, he didn't even stay, but he ruled from Kush. King Pi declared that the conquering of Egypt was a holy war, as the Kushites believed that Egypt had somehow been religiously and culturally corrupted and had to be cleansed from all its foreign unrighteousness. This is the only time in history a group of people actually conquered another state with the sole declarative purpose of restoring what they believed to be theirs. Essentially, Egypt's fears were realized. But eventually, like all empires, the Kushite Empire fell due to the Assyrian invasion. The Kushites moved their capital to Meroe, and this begins a new glorious era in Kushite history, one that's filled with many kings and queens. When the Kushites moved to Meroe, their culture takes on an even more unique Kushite element. They even create their own script called Meroitic. Even though the script was invented earlier by the Kushites, it flourishes during the Meroitic period.
Meroitic. Another language we can learn. We learned that, man. You know how songs, rap songs, clothing, shoes, if we learn that language, man, everything is there. They hold that whole history, everything. And we already know the knowledge of the United States stuff. Man, we can put that, fuse that into that language. Man, what?
Kush seemed to be a defensive powerhouse in the ancient world, as nobody seemed to be able to conquer it. Egypt tried again to conquer Kush and failed. While Kush was in its golden age, Egypt went into a steep decline. Nearly everyone who thought about conquering Egypt was able to do so. And while Egypt fell to the Assyrians, the Romans, the Greeks, the Byzantines, the Persians, and the Arabs, Kush maintained its independence against the Assyrians.
You hear Egypt failed to? Everybody came in and conquered Egypt. But not Kush, though.
Assyrians, Persians, and Romans. Kush finally fell to Aksum during the latter end of its dominance and broke up into three Christian kingdoms. These Christian kingdoms again maintained their independence during the Arab invasion. Intermarriage with Arabs over time introduced Islam into the region today. The history.
I guess that's when God, that's where we start, that's how we got lighter. So it wasn't white people. It was the Arabs. Damn. So I wonder, is that where the skin start? Yeah. The skin start changing the colors. And they start introducing Islam. Fuse that together too with it. Take all of it. It's right there waiting for us.
The history of ancient Nubia is very complex and unique. Today, many people get confused because the Greeks referred to Kushites and other Nubian populations as Ethiopians. But this term always referred to Nubian people and not modern-day Ethiopians. This confusion happened because King Ezana, a king of Aksum, actually studied Greek literature and decided to use the term Ethiopian and apply it to his own people. Also, the term Kushitic is confused with ancient Kushites, which are two different things. The term Kushitic usually refers to modern-day Horn Africans and was a term that...
Kushitic.
Was obviously borrowed from the ancient Kushites, as they were the most popular Nubians in the region. Cushitic refers to Afro-Asiatic speakers, but the Cushites themselves were Nilo-Saharan speakers. So as we can see, there are many ancient and modern perspectives that confuse the issue when it comes to Nubian history, but more specifically, Kushite history. So I'm all out, guys. If you want access to full-blown African history videos and sources, you can support the Home Team on Patreon. It's in the description box below. It's your boy, Home Team. Know thyself. Remember your ancestors. Peace.
Now let's look at another one. Pre-Karma, Ancient Nubian, Part 1, Pre-Karma, Kingdoms of Kush, The Black Community 2.0. See, look, Nubian, a geographical region along the Nile River, spanning present-day southern Egypt and northern Sudan, home to the ancient kingdoms of Kush. Should have said southern Sudan too. Well, let's go.
Hi, my name is Deborah Hurd. I'm an archaeologist. In addition to being an archaeologist, I'm also an Egyptologist and a Nubiologist. What does that mean? Well, that means that I...
Nubiologist. That's crazy. And if we gonna go back and change the word black, we gotta go back to Nubians. And we gotta stick that, like, we gotta even talking in history, like, yeah, it was Nubian slaves too in America. Like, we gotta talk it all the way through. The Nubian community. Oh, that's what Nubians do. Man, you talk like a Nubian. Don't let me go get them 10 Nubians on you. Where my Nubian peoples at? Like shit like that. It's gonna be hard though, but we can try. It's been tried before. But we gotta stick to that shit though.
I also study the ancient societies of Egypt and Nubia. We also refer to the region as the Nile Valley. So you can say that I'm an archaeologist of Nile River Valley civilizations.
My name is Shayla Monroe. I am an archaeologist, but I am a special type of archaeologist. I'm called a zooarchaeologist, and I study the relationship between people and animals in the past. And if you'd like to learn more about what zooarchaeologists do, please watch the film Meet a Zooarchaeologist.
Hi, my name is Janelle Marshall, and I'm a bioarchaeologist that works in Sudan. Bioarchaeology is the study of human skeletal remains, and we study this to help us understand how people lived in the past and how they interacted with their environment.
I'm Solange Ashby. I am an Egyptologist, although I specialize in ancient Nubia.
Man, why is a lot of women and where the dudes at, man? Oh, man, why they turn off the comment section? Oh, I hope they weren't getting hate, man. This some bullshit. This is some real life. Man, y'all cut them, what's the names back on, man? Don't be scared. Y'all gonna talk about Nubians, but y'all want to fight on the internet like some Nubians? Man, cut that, man. If y'all, man, look, you lucky I can't leave a comment. Let me see something. See if they got it over here too.
It's time to retrieve all those files you thought you lost. Real. This hard drive recovery converter from Zilkey connects to any of your hard drives and instantly retrieves all your...
...12,000 years ago, the Pleistocene ended.
For an astounding...
My name is Janelle Marshall, and I'm a bioarchaeologist that works in Sudan. Bioarchaeology is the study of human skeletal remains.
We study this to help us understand how people lived
in the past and how they interacted with their environment.
I'm Solange Ashby. I am an Egyptologist, although I specialize in ancient Nubia.
Who's who? A person who receives and studies materials remain to understand human history. A Nubiologist, a person who studies the history, language, and culture of ancient Nubia. I might want to add that under my belt. A Nubiologist. Yeah, that's kind of hard to say the Z word. The zoologist. Zoo, archaeologist, whatever. A person who studies animal remains recovered from, archaeological sites to understand the relationship between people and animals in the past. A person who studies bones recovered from archaeological studies to understand human life. What the fuck did I say? Recovered.
Ancient Nubia has an amazing 3,000-year history that runs in parallel with that of Egypt to its north. The initial populations in the Nile Valley consisted of A-group Nubians to the north and the pre-Kerma people who lived at the site of Kerma at the Third Cataract. Following the pre-Kerma period, the Kerman civilization comes into being around 2600 BC.
See that? Even over here. All this. Black community, we call it the Kush community, the Nubian community, since it's a lot of different black people, we just say the Nubian community.
And last for an astounding 1,000 years. But their kings were very powerful and buried under huge mound burials. The next Nubian kingdom was that of Napata. From about 900 BC until about 300 BC.
Napata. Ain't never heard of that either. Napata. See, that could be a good name for a shoe name, clothing name, rapper name, whatever you Napata, and you do the history. That's hard. I like that name, Napata. What cologne is that? Oh, that's that Napata. What that brand of clothes called? Oh, it's called Napata. Oh, that's hard, Napata. Hey, Napata.
you may have heard of these Kushite kings that formed the 25th dynasty in Egypt, famous pharaohs like Pianki and Taharqa. The final Nubian kingdom runs from about 300 BC until about 300 AD, and that's the kingdom of Meroe, where we have amazing gold riches, jewelry, pyramid burials, and very powerful ruling queens. But before we get too deep into each of these individual kingdoms, let's take it back, and start at the beginning of Nubian history.
That's hot.
So we've gone back almost 12,000 years. Why?
Not it did the Myron though.
Because 11,700 years ago, the climate was not exactly the same as it is now. So what was happening? Well, around 12,000 years ago, the Pleistocene ended. What's the Pleistocene, you might ask? Well, that was the last ice age. And from there, we moved into the period called the Holocene. The Holocene is the time period in which we currently live. But what was going on during that transition between the Pleistocene and the Holocene? Well, the glaciers began to melt. And as the glaciers melted, that meant an increase in water in the oceans and in seas, which also meant rain began to fall again. Grasslands began to grow, starting from the south at the equator, where the rain belts had been, and moving north progressively, going towards what we now know as the Sahara Desert. So between 9,000 and 7,000 years ago, instead of it being a barren wasteland, the desert was actually green and lush, which meant there were animals, there were lakes, there were rivers. And as the animals migrated to the north, so did people. As these people were coming together, then you have different groups of people that are mixing and mingling with each other. But over time, because the good times can't last forever, about 6,000 years ago, the area began to dry out again. The deserts began to return. And over the next 2,000 years, we see a massive return of desertification throughout that region that had previously been the grasslands of Northeast Africa. So what does that mean for the people? Well, the people had been migrating in search of food. So people had been migrating from south to north. People had also been migrating east and west. As the land became drier and drier, people started to seek out more permanent water sources. And one of those water sources was the Nile River.
Time and space, the last galactical period or ice age lasted from about 2,580,000, 11,700 years ago, the current geological time period that began about 11,000 years ago, Green Sahara, the period of transition from the whatever that P word, not H word, Holocene, when Northern Africa was wetter than it is today, also known as the Africa Humid Period. The moment of people from one location to another to settle temporarily or permanently. Migration.
The Nile River is composed of three branches. The White Nile, which flows from Uganda.
See that? Uganda, South Sudan, Sudan, Egypt, Ethiopia, Somalia. Man, this whole shit right here. Could be a kingdom of Kush, the black community 2.0. I say the whole Africa, but politics. Yeah, it sounds good on paper, but in reality, politics and all that stuff, a lot of people not going to agree with it.
From Lake Victoria, the Blue Nile, which flows from Lake Tana in Ethiopia, and the Atbara River, which flows from the Tekazi River, also in Ethiopia. Now, these three branches came together during that phase of the Green Sahara that we just talked about, inside of what we currently now know as Sudan. And from there, it flows all the way out to the Mediterranean. The Nile River is the world's longest river at well over 4,000 miles. It is one of the only rivers in the world to flow from south to north. The interesting thing about that is that during one of those really early geological periods, the earth shifted so much, the plates, the rifting and the shifting, that the area around Ethiopia and Kenya are elevated in relationship to the areas around Sudan and Egypt. So water flows from the highlands of Ethiopia and Uganda all the way down to the Nile River Valley. The people of the Nile Valley actually oriented themselves to its flow. So for them, south was up and north was down. So Upper Nubia was the southern portion of Nubia, and Lower Nubia was the northern part. Another way that we can classify the geography of ancient Nubia is by the river itself. Within the river, there are a group of rock outcrops that we call cataracts. There are six of these major cataracts in the Nile River between Khartoum and Aswan. They're numbered 1 through 6, with 6 being the southernmost right below Khartoum, and the northernmost being at Aswan, which was the ancient boundary between Nubia and Upper Egypt.
The traditional landscape of Nubia had a profound impact on the religious beliefs of the people. For example, the wide open desert spaces, the life-giving Nile River that flowed through the land, each generated various gods and goddesses worshipped by the Nubian people. The river itself was considered sacred, with water spirits inhabiting the river. The natural plateau of Jebel Barkal at the Fourth Cataract has long been held by the local people to be a sacred site dedicated to the worship of the god Amun. This god Amun was assimilated then to a local ram god who had traditionally been worshipped in Nubia as early as the Kerma period. They shared many gods with the ancient Egyptians, the cow-headed goddesses Hathor and Isis, for example, originate in Egypt, but were probably assimilated to local Nubian cow goddesses. the hawk-headed god Horus was very prominent in Nubian religion, although adopted from their Egyptian neighbors to the north. Nubians watched and studied the night sky. Their astronomical skill is attested from prehistory to the latest periods of the Kingdom of Meroe. At Nabtaplaya, a prehistoric site in the Nubian desert, calendar circles made of large stones are aligned with the rise.
They study the stars. Like, how they know which star was which? Mind blowing.
Of the star Sirius, which coincided with the onset of seasonal rains that brought life to the Green Sahara.
Nubia, geographical region along the Nile River spanning present-day southern Egypt and northern Sudan. Nile River Valley, the low land surrounding the Nile River, where the contemporary civilizations of Kush, Nubian, and Egypt developed a series of six shallow whitewater rapid and rocky outcrops in the Nile River between Khartoum, Sudan, Aswan, and Egypt. Flat elevated land from that rises sharply above the surrounding land. I could read.
We tend to describe the people who were moving in and out of the Nile Valley at this time as the primary pastoral community. These people were more dependent on cattle and starting to build their lives and their ideology around the presence of cattle. They also used certain markers to identify themselves as cattle people, so to speak. So when we look at their makeup, they have more colors in their makeup than people who aren't taking care of cattle. They have evidence of piercings that might have been rubbed against the bottom of their skull. We can see that when we look at their bodies. They have larger earrings made out of more colorful material. And the combs, we see lots of really cool combs that look a little bit like Afro.
Man, don't look like they made out of bone. Their hair must be long.
Picks, and they've got little animals carved on them. So we know that.
Look at that. That's crazy. Is this wood or marble? I wonder what it's made out of.
That people are paying a lot more attention to their hair and their hairstyles. They're coming into the Nile Valley with this full pastoralist drip, and they're stunting on everybody because they're the cattle people, and they dress and they look and they act like they're celebrating cattle all the time.
The celebration of cattle didn't stop in life. We also see it carried over in death through Nubian burial.
Y'all better not laugh at her teeth. She trying. Y'all better not. And she trying to get that high value, man. She's showing y'all she's smart.
Burial customs. One of the most common burial practices that we see throughout Nubia is burying their loved ones with Bukrania. And Bukrania are male cattle with the horns and the skull, and they were often painted and had geometric patterns on it, really beautiful features. Cattle herding was a very important feature of Nubian society. And so it makes sense that we see this carried out even in the afterlife. The early graves in Nubia consisted of earthen mounds that we refer to as tumuli, and they're usually constructed with a pit and a chamber. Typically, local leaders were buried in tumuli, and they were placed on leather blankets and typically covered with leather blankets.
We find that they typically laid the body of the deceased on its side. This is something that bioarchaeologists call a flex position. You can think of it as similar to a fetal position, where they lay on their side with their knees crouched, and it looks like they're sleepy.
The grave goods consisted of many things like ostrich feathers.
I wonder what do the laying them straight mean? The Nubian, they put it in a fetal position like they would sleep. That's interesting.
Jewelry, amulets, sandals, and even daggers.
Other ways that Nubians express their cultural traditions include tattooing. For example, in the earlier periods, we see primarily Nubian women sporting diamond-shaped tattoos around their waist or on their upper shoulders. They wore cowrie shell belts as part of their attire that really closely matches that of priestesses of Hathor.
Priestesses of Hathor? The practice of domesticating, herding, and grazing animals while moving across the landscape, a cattle skull, an earthen burial mound covering a burial, often decorated with stones, and a flexed position, a burial position where the deceased is laid on their side with their knees bent.
So when we talk about Nubian states, the one that we know of by name is Kush. When we first see Kush appear in any records, it is during Egypt's sixth dynasty. So an official talks about going to Kush to recruit mercenaries or soldiers to fight in the Egyptian army. Kush, at that point, was in Upper Nubia around the third cataract, at a place called Kerma. Kerma reached its height during Egypt's Middle Kingdom, moving from settlements of groups of people moving into the area and becoming a centralized chiefdom and then eventually a state
the foundation
during Egypt's Middle Kingdom period.
The early economy of Kerma was built on a combination of intensified agriculture and animal pastoralism. When Egypt starts to build its wealth by trading products throughout the Mediterranean, Kerma builds a simultaneous wealth as an intermediary. So even though Egypt was moving a lot of these African products like exotic animals, gold, gemstone, etc., out of the African continent into the Mediterranean, part of the way that Kerma built its wealth during the Kerma Classic period was pulling all of those products through their trade networks out of the central part of the African continent, up the Nile Valley, down the river, towards Egypt.
During the height of the Kerman Kingdom, we begin to see the material items and customs grow bigger and larger and more elaborate. And we begin to see more marked differences in how the local leaders are buried. And some of the tumuli are up to 90 meters in diameter. So think of a giant Ferris wheel. These are huge burials for local leaders. Yeah. They are decorated with these black and white stones during this time as well. And you gotta think, this is the desert. And so black and white stones really stand out to also show just how important this person was. We see individuals laid on cow hides. And these cow hides are laid on top of beds. Burial beds are one of the most important features of Nubian culture. The burial bed legs were often shaped like cows, again, tying back to the cattle culture that they have. And they were often wrapped in gold foil.
That's crazy. See? Even designs, everything there. Resurrection of the Kush Kingdom.
Head and the footboards often had decorations made of ivory, and they depicted geometric patterns, plants, animals that must have been in that area during the time, such as lions, hyenas, elephants. And some of my favorite depictions are of the imaginary creatures, like the flying giraffes. The use of beds is an enduring cultural trait in Nubia.
Shit, it might not have been imaginary creature. It could have been for real. You call them giraffes, them could have been flying horses.
And we find evidence of their use well into the later Meroitic period and even today sometimes. Another enduring feature of Nubian culture that we see during the Kerma period is still the use of Bucrania, but large amounts of it. In one of the local leaders' tombs, we found 5,000 Bucrania. That is a lot of bull heads. Can you imagine the little horns sticking out of the ground and you seeing 5,000? That is a lot.
See, and Hollywood tricked us to think that that's some evil shit. That's crazy.
And that also symbolizes just how wealthy that ruler was during their reign.
Kerma reached its height during Egypt's Middle Kingdom, to the point where it actually became a threat to Egyptian sovereignty. During Egypt's second intermediate period, Egypt was plagued with a dynasty to its north called the Hyksos, who were a foreign people, and the Nubians to the south, mainly the people at Kerma. The Egyptian king was fearful that the Nubians would make an alliance with the Hyksos and divide up Egypt between the two of them. He actually caught a messenger on the road from Lower Egypt trying to get to Kerma to ask for assistance in defeating the Egyptian king. At the end of the 17th dynasty, an Egyptian king arose that was able to finally defeat the Hyksos and run them out of Egypt and regain control of Lower Egypt. After defeating the Hyksos and running them out of Egypt, the king, Akhmose, turned his sights on Kerma. From there, a succession of at least four pharaohs waged war against Kush until finally reaching defeat under the reign of Hatshepsut and Thutmose III. At that point, an independent state of Kush no longer existed at Kerma, but became a colony of the Egyptian state. So Kerma was a colony of the Egyptian state for about 450 years. That wasn't just a willing colonization, though. There were times when the Kushites in Kerma rebelled against the Egyptians. The downfall of the Egyptian state into another intermediate period that resulted in the final ending of colonialism in Kerma.
All that black on black crime. Kush, a kingdom in the Northeast Africa with capitals at Kerma, Napata, and Monroe. Kerma, the first kingdom of Kush and powerful city state. Bam, that'll be our capital for the black community. The black community 2.0. Sovereignty, supreme power or authority, the authority of a state to govern itself or other states. Colonialism, the policy and practice of controlling, occupying, and exploiting a group of people in their territory. We knocked this off right here. Between us, we'll never have to worry about nothing else again. Well, I ain't gonna say that, but because, you know, some people, I can handle my own shit. Or they go to another kingdom
Take out that kingdom and tell them all their secrets. Hey. It's the inner. It's the end of part one. Part two, I'm going to do a little later on. So y'all hold it down, don't file out, and don't crash out. And I'm out. Yeah.